Hello and welcome to my latest walkthrough, which is for Wanted Monty Mole. This wasn't my intended next video. I intended to do something on my game, a demo of my game, and maybe a different walkthrough that I'd done quite a while ago. But I started playing Monty Mole about 3 or 4 weeks ago and just kept playing it, and I never thought I'd be able to complete it, but I started to believe I could if I got lucky with the crushers. More about the crushers later. And in the end, I managed to get a run through and complete it. A bit like Jet Set Willy 2, I think I'll only end up completing this game once, because once you've mastered the game, once you know what to do, it's all about luck, really, and luck getting past the crushers. I remember seeing an interview by the author, and he said if he could change one thing in Wanted Monty Mole, it would be that he'd stop the crushers from being random. And I really wish he hadn't made them random, because the crushers in this game can be really, really unfair. But other than that, this is a great game. You play Monty Mole, you're on a quest to get coal, you're all cold. It was set during the miners' strike, way back in 1984. Written by Peter Harrop and released by Gremlin Graphics, it got terrific reviews when it first came out, and even beat Jet Set Willy to be the platform game of the year in the Crash Readers Awards that year. As you can see, it has nice big chunky sprites and is very, very colourful, with a little bit of colour clash, but not too much. You have to collect the glowing pieces of coal, and the game is kind of segmented into different sections, in that when you collect all the pieces of coal in one section, a door opens and allows you to get to the next section. But you can't backtrack, so you have to make sure you do everything as you go through every one of the screens. It's very difficult to backtrack in this game. You can also collect extra objects that do things, kill baddies, let you pass certain obstacles in the game. Now, the first few screens are actually really difficult. That crusher that you get on about the second or third screen that I've already been past is really difficult. And later on in the games, there are crushers that are very, very difficult to get past unless you're lucky and they don't crush you. Because as I said, the crushers are random, so there's no skill involved really in being able to get past them. I guess there's a kind of luck. Sometimes if the crusher goes down 3 or 4 times quickly, you think, oh, it's going to wait now. I don't know how the random number generator on the spectrum works, but it seems to be you don't get a lot of really short crushers. The gameplay itself is, to be honest with you, pretty simple. Once you've worked out how to do a screen, you can nearly do it every single time. There isn't a huge amount of skill involved, and getting to the end is really luck. Some of the screens towards the end are very, very tricky at first. But this is my least favourite crusher. Several times I've got to this screen with 3 lives, and then lost every single life trying to get through this crusher. This is the first of the doorways that I mentioned, so when I collect the bit of coal on this screen, the doorway will disappear and you can go past. You also have to collect that axe, which gets rid of that spinning red wheel on the rope. The controls are OPQA space. You can go up and down ropes, left, right of course, and space jumps. Now that's a little trick I learned to get past this crusher or get into that gap safely. If you can kind of walk through platforms in the middle of them, and then when you get to the impassable brickwork, you'll stop, which is good for lining yourself up, but it's quite tricky to do. There's also those floor sections that kind of move in and out. They can be quite tricky. There's a really tricky piece later on. Now here's an example where you get the plunger, it allows you to get rid of that face, and then you can go past. And the dynamite up above allows you to get rid of that jumping up and down miner's helmet. But going that way makes the game a little bit more tricky. One thing you can do with the crushers is, jump through them. When they're moving upwards, they only seem to kill you when you're moving down. Now, that can be used to your advantage, but on some of the screens, it doesn't really help you. There's a nice variety of different baddies in this game. That jumping shark in the previous screen is a particular favourite of mine. I think that looks really, really good. Once you've worked out that you can walk through the crusher as it moves up, that one isn't too hard. Now this is the end of the second section of the game. There's another wall that'll disappear when you get all the coal. One thing about those walls though, you have to get the last bit of coal in the room where the wall is. Which again, makes the game a little bit harder, but once you know what you're doing, it's a lot easier. And once you've removed a wall in a game, if you die in that room, the wall goes back and there's no way to get rid of it again, because your coal is all gone. The coal doesn't respawn, but the wall does, which again can make the game tricky. Now this crusher is the one I really, really hate, because you've got to jump over that water and avoid the crusher. You can see I waited quite a while here, trying to time it exactly so I get past. And remember, if I die here, that's it, game over. Now this next section that we come to is probably my favourite. All of this pipe work that you can climb along adds an extra dimension to the game. I quite like this piece. Although, again, once you've mastered it, once you know how to get through all the screens and collect all the pieces of coal, it's actually quite easy. So, a bit more trivia about this game. This game was the first in a series. The next one was Monty is Innocent, then Monty on the Run, Alvida Saint Monty, Impossum Mole, and Morley Christmas, which was a cover tape release on Your Sinclair. I've never played Morley Christmas. I've played Monty on the Run. I've not played Monty is Innocent, but that really isn't a Monty Mole game. That's a Sam Stort game. Sam Stort being another one of Gremlin's characters. There was a little bit of controversy about this game, as at the end it features a caricature of Arthur Scargill, who was the leader of the Miners' Union at the time. While that's true, I think that was blown a bit out of proportion. It's just a bit of a caricature. And the media kind of hammed it up at the time. Of course, no publicity is bad publicity for a game, so it probably led to increased game sales. There is a Commodore 64 version of this game that was developed in parallel and is a completely different game. I've played it really briefly. I don't like it as much as this version of Wanted Monty Mole though. It's kind of more of a Boulder Dash clone and not as good as the original Boulder Dash. Back to the game, and another part of this section of the game is that you have to use the minecarts to get from one part of the screen to the next. Just here, I'll have to drop onto the minecart and run along with it. Now this particular screen in the game is really difficult, and this is another one that ends this section. The wall in the bottom right of the game will disappear once all the pieces of coal have been collected. And once again, there is a piece of coal on another screen that you have to get first, so you can't get the last piece of coal in this screen before you've got the piece of coal in the next screen. And there's a nice little visual effect when you come back into this screen, having got rid of the wall, where the minecart tips you over that edge piece. And then you're into the last few screens of the game, and they are pretty tricky. So here we go, and there's that nice little animated section. Now things do get difficult in this screen and for the next few. The screen after this is my least favourite in the game. Oh, and where's my favourite? It's the most tricky anyway. I quite enjoyed trying to work out how to do that screen when I first came to it. While I've completed this now, I'm not sure I could have completed this back in the day, because I use save states to practice these last few screens. I think you could save game states with a multiface one. Perhaps with one of those I'd have been able to complete the game. As I said before, there's no backtracking in this game, so it's a really linear game. You just go from one screen to the next completing it. It's almost a cross between Manic Miner and Jet Set Willy. I was really annoyed with myself when I died there. As I said, this is probably my favourite screen. It's quite tricky. Once you work out how to complete it, it's not too bad though. This probably took the most practice of any of the screens on the game. This next jump, you've got to time just right. Otherwise, you get trapped between that little devil thing and the fireball that comes up through the screen. I decided not to go there. I only just made it in the end anyway. Again, this crusher feels really unfair. This one you can't walk through as it moves up. I don't know if it's something to do with the changing colour. But that makes it particularly difficult. I definitely have a love-hate relationship with this game. As you've seen, I died twice trying to get through this, and one more life gone, and that's it, game over. I have one more crusher to negotiate. This is the last one in the game. And again, it's just a case of waiting and going at the right moment. I like the way that the face changes in this game. It's a kind of evil face when it goes up and a scared face when it goes down. Getting past that bit is a little bit tricky. Once you work out how to do it, it's not too bad though. And this is the final screen with the caricature of Arthur Scargill. Again, there's a wall that disappears, so you can't die in this game. If you get what I think was supposed to be that object there, which is a ballot paper, then that will defeat Arthur. Because he famously refused to have a ballot for the miners' strike. Could have timed this jump right as well. You've kind of got to get him from above. So if I walk along now, I don't think it kills him. So that's it, Wanted Monty Mole. Sorry it's been so long since I've put a video up. I will do a demo of my Spectrum game that I've been writing. For those who don't know, it's a kind of cross between Lords of Midnight and Bard's Tale. As I always say at this point, let's watch that all again, just a bit faster.
nearly 32 years since I first saw your title screen. And even though I never got that far, I lay awake most every night and think about the rooms ahead, where everything just seemed to get so hard. I never got this close before, I never got this near to completing Jet Set Willy. So go get me another beer. From my cassette, I even fixed the attic bug that screwed me over all those years ago. I played it on my BBC. I never liked those rubber keys, but everyone's a critic, I suppose. I never got this close. I never got listening to completing Jet Set Willy. So go get me another beer.
I hope you enjoyed that, the video and the music. The music was Jet Set Willy by the British IBM, and I will leave a link in the show notes to where you can buy that track. So that was my first video for a long time and my walkthrough of Wanted Monty Mole. Until next time, happy gaming!